So with that, let's turn the lights down and we'll talk about some radiocarbon dating. So when I started meeting with the Ancient Historical Research Foundation, the AHRF, Jay Barton talked about this, in particular, talked about this box. And Jay mentioned Paul Chessman, his wife is Millie Chessman. Well, John Brewer uncovered this box that was pictured by Sean and brought this box out of the cave. Anyway, the one of these boxes made its way to Paul, was given to Paul Chessman by Brewer. Millie has retained the bark, and that's what I was most interested in. I mean, you might be interested in the plates, but for me, the bark, you know. And why is the bark so interesting? It's because you can get a radiocarbon date. It's got carbon in there, and it gives you a chance for a radiocarbon date. As we'll see, you have to be real careful on this dating. It's easy to get an erroneous date. I'll explain why. But this was pulled out by John Brewer, we understand. You know, I tend to be a little skeptical, but then puzzle pieces start falling together, and I start saying, better take a closer look at this. By the way, the bark is actually juniper. We say cedar in Utah, but if you, I took it to an expert there at BYU, he said it's juniper. And the pitch is, it's probably not juniper, but this was something, I can't remember his name that I took it to there at BYU, but he said that the Indians were known to waterproof things by putting bark and then pitch around it. That was the effort there to waterproof them. Well, this slide has quite a bit on it, but back in 1975, Paul Chessman secured a report on a radiocarbon date. This is the first effort to date the bark, and I just learned about this from Terry, actually not too long ago. But in the report, it says they dated the pitch and cedar bark, covering one of the stone boxes. Now, again, this box was pulled out of there about 1959. Now, the fact that they're dating the pitch with the bark tells me that this is the outer bark, because the inner bark doesn't have pitch. I mean, if you're careful, it's just the outside then has that pitch on the bark. Anyway, the report said that the sample is not older than 205 years. And so right about that time, in fact, that report came out in August, September, and November of that year. There were articles in the Deseret News, as I mentioned there, 26 November, in which certain archaeologists were saying, well, this whole thing is a hoax and it must be dismissed. And the proximity in time there leads me to suggest that it was this radiocarbon dating that made these archaeologists, for one thing, suspect, or bold to say. I mean, they weren't just suggesting this might be a hoax. They were saying, this is a hoax, this guy's a fraud, et cetera, et cetera. Okay. It's pretty severe, the language in these articles and in their scientific papers they presented at this time. Anyway, what I looked at was the hydrogen bomb testing in the 1950s and 60s. We now know, I don't know, they should have known it back then, but there's no mention of this in the report. Carbon-14 is released in abundance in these hydrogen bomb tests. Utah happens to be downwind from the tests that were done in Nevada. And therefore, this carbon-14 would almost certainly, I mean, you'd expect that, would be on the outside of this box, on the pitch, the outer portions of this box. So already, that means, see, if you have a lot of carbon-14 in a wooden or a material that had grown, then that's younger. If less carbon-14, that's older. So that's just in a nutshell how that works. And so if you have a lot of carbon-14 due to the hydrogen bomb testing, it would appear younger, see? Whether, it doesn't matter how old it really was, just contaminating this sample with the atomic bomb blast, called the bomb pulse, is what archaeologists call this carbon-14, would make the sample appear young. So we redid the carbon-14 dating in two ways. Is the HRF now, working with BYU, the laboratory here, radiocarbon lab here. And also we use the, in Miami, beta analytic laboratory. So Millie Chessman gave us a sample of the bark. And last year we carefully extracted, first of all, a sample of the inner bark. Now, I was really careful to do that. I've worked with radiocarbon dating for a long time. I've processed probably 3 dozen samples from different sources for radiocarbon dating. And I said, we need to go in deep and get a sample which hasn't been contaminated. So it's been protected from the bomb pulse. The preliminary result was that the age, we call it the calibrated age, is 2514 plus or minus 114 BC before Christ. Some of you might have seen that date. It's kind of gotten out, but that date turns out to have a calibration error. And as I, yeah. Even more, huh? Okay, so the age that came from our preliminary effort was 2514 BC. So that's what, 4,500 years ago. But I told the guys at the lab, I said, that seems awfully old. I mean, there must be some error there. And they did check. They said, we've been getting other dates that seem too old, and they checked. There's this NIST, that's the National Standards Organization of the government. They'd use oxalic acid, calibration, but they actually used oxalic acid too. So that's a detail. But anyway, I talked to Dr. David Tingey about this, and he wrote to me recently. The error was resolved by running samples both in our lab and at the Center for Applied Isotopic Studies at the University of Georgia. And so that preliminary result had to be corrected. So the final result, which I assure you has been checked many times now, and so we're confident in this. The final carbon-14 result you can see there is that the age, we decided to go ahead and announce this here. First of all, to correct this earlier report that got out, but it's between 5 BC and 390, and so BC. So it's definitely very old. Now, what does this? Oh well. First of all, you know, we got kind of excited about that in the group because it suggests then, well, it shows that the bark was old. Now you'd say, well, it's possible that John Brewer found found a 2,000-year-old tree, and then made his okay. You know, it's a little far-fetched. So. I mean, to think of that. But anyway, it certainly gives us a reason to think that John Brewer is onto something here. We did one other thing, though. We went ahead and took a sample of the outer bark and pitch, as was done in 75, as we read those reports. And the result we obtained there is that there is 103%, in other words, more than 100% of modern carbon. So this. And then I quote from the report, this is from Beta Analytic, the source of the carbon-14 causing the sample to have more activity than the standard, more than modern, is extra C14 generated during atomic bomb testing in the 1950s. Remember, this box was pulled out in about 1959. When we see this, we generally know the sample must have been respiring carbon after 1950. In this case, it indicates very strongly that the 1975 carbon-14 dating was flawed because they took a sample that was exposed to the bomb pulse. So, conclusions. The inner bark used to cover the stone box is indeed ancient. Dating to just before the birth of Christ. I remind you, this is also consistent. I mean, this cave is not far from where we saw the Mayan hand symbols, which I call Mayan. I don't think too many people know about that, you know, mark right where it's supposed to be in the Mayan hand. The outer bark, on the other hand, is clearly contaminated with bomb pulse carbon-14. And we conclude the findings and claims of John Brewer should be re-examined in light of this positive evidence for the antiquity of the boxes. Certainly, it's highly desirable to reopen the cave where the boxes were found with archaeologists present, assuming the cave can be found. And when I say archaeologists, again, I'm thinking back to what Aaron Jordan said this morning about how important it is. The provenience is the word they like to use. Now, where did this come from? And if we can find something in its context, in the place where it was placed anciently, then we can really get a final verification and also learn a lot about what the ancients were doing. As soon as something like that is pulled out of its original setting, well, we just lose our leverage in the scientific community, you see. But if we can preserve, just, you know, restrain yourself, don't touch it, like thinking of Joseph and the plates, don't touch it, you know. Maybe it'll shock them if they try to touch it now, because I warned you, okay. Yeah. But anyway, so don't touch it. Let's get some reliable archaeologists. You know, Jay Barton said the Crespi collection was turned over. But we know, to some archaeologists also, that melted things down. I'm sitting there, you know, who hired these guys? But that was in a foreign country. None of us. Well, okay, I do know a couple archaeologists. No, I don't think they do that, but I know some that I would rely on. Let me put it positively. And John Baxter's one of those. Aaron's another. And John will speak to us later. Anyway, the thing I want to emphasize is that if we can find artifacts in their original undisturbed context, it will allow verification of claims, in this case, Brewer's claims, and permit new discoveries to be made. Now, I'm not quite done. It sounds like I am, but I'm not. Because I want to come back to something that Jay, we didn't even coordinate this. He was talking about separating wheat from chaff. I use the Savior's parable separating wheat from tares. It's the same thing. In this field, as in many others, there are certainly tares and there is wheat. And I've listed some topics here. I want to take just a minute and ask for what people think, you see. So now I'm going to ask you what you think about, I'd like you to raise your hand. If you don't have an opinion, you don't have to raise your hand. But if you have an opinion one way or the other, wheat or tares, North African, Phoenician, Middle Eastern travel to the Americas long before Columbus, wheat. Thank you. Tares. Uh-huh. It's a good group, see? This way. I haven't. Okay, Chinese, Asian travel to the Americas long before Columbus, wheat. Good. Tares. Okay, we're doing good, see? Of course, that was my talk this morning, so now I'm hoping that horses in the Americas long before Columbus, wheat. Tares. Okay. Burroughs Cave. Okay, Russ, wherever you are, here's your... how many think that Burroughs Cave in Illinois, that Russ Burroughs talked about this morning, has ancient artifacts, including stones with writing, some of which are on display? Wheat. How many think tares on that one? Okay, that's fair. A couple. All right, that's okay. Brewer Cave, haha. This is the one I just talked about here. So, with ancient art, you see, I'll just close my mouth. How many think that's wheat? Burroughs Cave, tares. Okay, all right. Okay, what's that? Yeah? Some of the plates were found to be fabricated, but I'm talking about that there would be some, here's what I mean here, that really would be authentically ancient. Okay, the mystery glyphs. This is Terry Carter's talk. Near Manti, Kanab, Fillmore, etc. As ancient writings. How many think that's wheat? Tares? So I'm glad to see Garth raising it. You think it's wheat? Oh, and tares, mixed. Okay, that's fair. That's certainly... Okay, I'm almost done here. Spanish miners in Utah before Escalante. Wheat. Absolutely. Look at those hands go. Tares? Okay. 100%, I think. Montezuma's treasure. You know the story. Buried in southern Utah or thereabouts, somewhere. I mean, it could be Arizona, Texas, but somewhere north of Mexico City. Montezuma's treasure. Wheat?
Salt Lake Valley.
Salt Lake Valley. Okay. Wheat? Tares. Interesting. Is that right? Okay, that's cool. I just, okay, see, we don't, you know. All right, see, that's the point of the AHRF. We're trying to sort this out. And we don't always agree among ourselves. The Lost Josephine and Rhodes Mines, which I think June probably addressed some of that here. I don't know. We'll see. In the Uintas of Utah, wheat. Tares. Okay. How about the Padilla plates, if you've heard of these, from Mexico, you know, as authentically ancient. Wheat. And I have to disagree with you, Jay, on the tares. Oh, wheat and tares. Okay, Jay. Oh, that's interesting, Jay. I've talked to you about that. Soper said, I know, again, I disagree with some on this. From Michigan stones. Wheat. Soper Savage. Yeah, a lot of people don't know about this one. Tares. I think some, well, there may, oh, both, okay. I agree, that's possible. Kinderhook plates. Wheat. No. Tares. I personally think James Talmadge talked about those. Okay, so that's just for fun, some of these now. Sasquatch. Okay, Sasquatch. Okay. Wheat. Okay. Have you seen such? Okay, you need to talk to Sean. Sean also has. Okay, and I believe Sean, so that's why my hand's up here. Tares on Sasquatch. Okay, that's cool, Aaron. I mean, you know, we have, right? Okay, UFO. This is really getting funny now. But I don't, okay, wheat. UFO sightings. Okay, tares. Okay, and I'm sitting here, I don't know. Okay, here's one. Shroud of Turin as the image of Jesus. How many would say that's wheat? If you know about it. Okay, tares. I'm going to have to go with tares on that one. Sorry, guys, but, you know, we're open for discussion. Mentana Archives, if you've heard of this. Sam P., this is supposedly a translation. Wheat, if you know about this one. Tares, I've read quite a bit of it myself.
Oh. Break that down, please.
The next one? Book of Mormon?
Break it down. Mesoamerica versus USA.
Ooh. I wasn't even sure if I was going to ask on this one because, you know, the content here. The Book of Mormon as a historically true document. That's interesting. I like your idea. Okay. That's a very interesting. In other words, as the people lived in Mesoamerica or the people lived in North America, not Mesoamerica, you know, accepting... How are we going to do that, though? Because there were probably... There's communication between the two. Is that... I'm just going to have to do it black and white. It's just because I think, you know, like Garth and I are saying, that there's communication, clearly, between Mesoamerica and this Four Corners area, anyway. So
I... Not the point of the Book of Mormon, what it talks about, the Nephites and Lamanites, where they actually live.
Right. Well... Well, I don't, you know, I'm doing the questioning here, but you have a point. I'm almost. Well, Okay, here we're getting off a little bit here, but read my book on hands. Okay, so let's just do the quick vote on this. Historically true document. That's it. Wheat and then tares. That's a fair question. That's cool. Okay. So I just want to point out here in conclusion then that all of the above are discussed on the AHRF forum. It's called Ancient Lost Treasures. If you do a Google search on Ancient Lost Treasures, that's an easy board forum. Most are subjects of active research by the AHRF. Sean talked about how to link up with, join us in this effort, which is to unearth the truth. Thank you.
There's a lot of topics there, Steve.